Some of you have your video on, Gigi, Nitika. Would you please switch off your video? Mr. Prabhakaran, your video is on. Could you please switch it off? Dr. Rajan Gurukul, are you ready? Are you ready, sir?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay. So shall we start? Yes. Good evening, all. The moderator for the day is Ansu Matthew, research scholar in the Department of History, Sri Shankaracharya University. She is working on designing and disseminating pasts, interrogating the histories of princely Cochin. Over to you, Ansu, for the session.
Thank you, ma'am. Before we begin, here are a few instructions to be noted. I request all to kindly mute the audio and turn off video until the session is over. You may mark your attendance in the Google form. The link will be provided in the chat box. You can also type your queries in the chat box during or at the end of the lecture. I will bring them once the presentation is over. Hope you are clear with all the instructions. So, without further ado, let's begin the session. Today, our speaker is Dr. Rajan Gurukul, historian and vice chairman of Kerala State Higher Education Council, talking on theoretical sensing of the past, sources and invisible evidence. I invite Ms. Usha Vijayan, research scholar, Department of History, to introduce honorable speaker and welcome the gathering.
Good evening, all. It is my immense pleasure to welcome Professor Rajan Gurukul to the second day of webinar series on behalf of Kerala Council for Historical Research and the Department of History, Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit, Karadi. Professor Rajan Gurukul, currently the Vice Chairman of Kerala State Higher Education Council, is a leading Indian social scientist, historian, and writer of many books and articles. His major works are Social Formations of Early South India, Rethinking Classical Indo-Roman Trade, History and Theory of Knowledge Production, and Introductory Outline. He was Vice Chancellor of Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, and Visiting Professor of Soundararajan Chair at the Center for Contemporary Studies in Institute of Science, Bangalore. I welcome both the participants and distinguished speaker to deliver the lecture on Theoretical Sensing of the Past, Sources and Invisible Evidence. Thank you, sir.
May I start?
Now I invite Dr. Rajan Gurukul to make his presentation.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. As already announced, the topic is sensing the past with theory, sources and invisible evidence. This lecture seeks to demonstrate the methodological advantages of sensing the past with theory. At the outset, the lecture deals with what a theory means and how it works in historical research. Then it illustrates as to how theory illumines in the source evidence otherwise invisible. What I mean is, you can see these kind of evidence only with the help of theory. Theory is an all-inclusive explanation of a phenomenon. It conceptualizes the phenomenon into a system or a structure or a whole made up of its constituents or parts. The theory explains the principle that controls the relationship between the system and its constituents, the system and its parts, or the structure and its parts, as well as the relationship amongst the constituents or parts. Constituents can signify the system even individually. That is, a single part of the whole structure can signify the structure as a whole. A part of the whole is a signifier to a theorist. As far as a theorist is concerned, part is not just a fragment, but a constituent which is capable of signifying the whole. A part is a position and function which the relation stabilizes. It's the relation that stabilizes the position, and then position also means the function. And then it is the reward that stabilizes the relation. We don't have to go into the details of these at this moment, but subsequently we will be certainly referring to this. If the whole thing is not clear to you, I can illustrate it with an example. Suppose we see a curvature, just a curvature. There are certain ways of understanding the curvature closely, and in the process sometimes you will discover that it is not just a curvature but a piece of a circle, an arc. Then it is not just a piece or it is not just a fragment but a signifier that can signify the full circle. But here what we have to note is everybody need not necessarily be capable of identifying the curvature as an arc that signifies the circle. Now how does she do that? Because she is knowledgeable in geometry. She knows theoretically a subject matter, and with the help of that knowledge, or to be specific in the context, theoretically knowledgeable. She is theoretically knowledgeable, and therefore she is able to identify the arc, and then there is a theoretical path to reach the circle, although the full circle is not present there. As I was talking about part or a constituent which is capable of signifying the full system or full structure. Now here, this example, I hope, might have made you the concept I just mentioned clear. That is, reaching to the full circle which is absent with the help of a theoretically identifiable fragment of it called the arc. Later on, we can think about this in the context of filling gaps in history. Particularly early history is fragmentary and you have a lot of gaps, and source material will give you clues, but a theoretically knowledgeable researcher will be able to identify signifiers among the clues so that the signified can be reached. We will make it further clear through examples subsequently. Let us go ahead with the outline that I have in mind. We would be discussing that the past sources that we have to sense will normally yield the outcome that is essentially tentative and fragmentary. As researchers in history, you know it very well. Source material is not giving you full picture of the past. And even when your source material is quite rich, you get only a tentative idea about the past, or the knowledge that you generate is tentative. And then it is always fragmentary. Hence, historical knowledge is inevitably incomplete. Theory helps pick signifiers from fragments in the source and reach the system. because you have this metaphor system in mind or the metaphor structure in mind, and you relate fragments that you locate in your source material to reach the tentatively intelligible thing called system or structure. Signifiers turn up as evidence of the absent system, as I have already illustrated with the help of arc circle relationship, but visible only to the theoretically knowledgeable. That also I made clear that a person knowledgeable in geometry alone will be able to identify an arc, and once that identification is made, there is a theoretically negotiated path to the full circle, and using that technique, the circle can be restored. Theoretically restored system can, in its turn, transform several fragments into signifiers, and sometimes signifiers of ideas, institutions, relations, processes, and dynamic. Using such systemic details, a theorist can extrapolate the known to the unknown, both backward and forward. For example, you have a very clear stage, methodologically attained, and there you have some clarity in terms of system or structure. And from there, you can travel backward using the logical strategy of extrapolation. You can also go forward using the same strategy of extrapolation. Sensing the past with the theory illumines new evidence in the source. That is also important. If you are theoretically knowledgeable, you will see that there are many new things coming up. It can be part of your own experience that you might have read the same source perhaps 10 years ago, 15 years ago. At that time, you might not have noticed many useful indicators in the source material. How come that after 10 years, 15 years, you are capable of identifying pointers, identifying clues? It's not just because you have better knowledge in the subject matter, but it is also because of your theoretical knowledge base for recognizing the clues or understanding the clues as signifiers. And then theory makes the invisible visible. That's a very important thing, and we will be making it clear with the example, with the help of examples. Then the inaudible, audible, and the incomplete, complete. Theory reveals contradictions in the explanations of avowedly theory-free narratives. I say avowedly theory-free narrative because most of us make a binary between theoretical study and then a simple narrative. Actually, there isn't anything like explanation-free narrative. Every narration has built-in explanatory process. In that sense, every historical work is basically explanatory. We don't have to distinguish a theory-based historical study as explanatory and a study that avowedly distances itself from theory is not explanatory. Every narrative is explanatory, and it need not necessarily at the same time be free of self-contradictory expressions or certain faulty, having certain faulty claims, all because of the over adherence to the empirical observation. As the historian is avowedly theory free in the narrative, there is always a tendency to emphasize empirical basis, and observations would be justified by saying that these observations are based on empirical study. Now, past as an object of knowledge is bewilderingly vast, least amenable to comprehension unless supported by a framework or an ordering device. That is the reason why I am saying every narrative has a framework without which narration is not possible. Nobody can do history without an ordering device. He who claims that he uses no device for it is not self-conscious about the device at work in what he does. That is the thing. You can see many people, as I said earlier, avowedly talking about using no framework, no theory, and committed only to talk about the past solely based on the source material. That way, the study is totally empirical. That is it. But if you draw closer to what he has written, you can see there are various devices at work. Devices for arranging, devices for making the whole narrative sensible. So there are various such devices. Sorting is a device, or classification is a device. Dividing itself is an important strategy for making the narrative sensible. So you divide, you classify, you categorize. So all these are devices for arranging or organizing the narrative. And you take a single tax, say sorting. Sorting is not just possible as, say, a technique. You have to be clear about why do you sort, how do you sort, on what basis. There, although the researcher is not conscious about the principle behind sorting, the principle behind classification, or the principle behind division, principle behind categorizing, that is at work. The overall relationship which is enabling the person to classify or divide or organize, that is important. So with the overall relationship in mind, that is the relationship that is intelligible to you, intelligible to the researcher, it makes sense to you, and hence you do accordingly. You classify because you have some principle behind, whether you are conscious about it or not. Any such device is a priori, meaning reasoning based on causation and generalization. We all understand things on a priori basis, or a priori reasoning is already there, and it is theoretical. You have some principle to depend upon, and the reasoning involves causation and generalization, without which you cannot narrate anything. You ask questions and then you constitute your answer, and the answer is an explanation. It is analytical. Any a priori understanding is analytical and it is explanatory, and therefore it is theoretical. In this sense, every historical narrative is theoretical. It is not this common a priori practice in historiography which I seek to discuss today. What dismantles this practice and exposes its self-contradictions is that I mean by theory. That's a different kind of theory. It is not a priori, but a posteriori reasoning. It is not just analytical, but it is a synthetic understanding of the analysis. It is therefore critical. You can in both ways call it critical theoretical. Critical theoretical as the philosophical understanding, and also critical theoretical as literary understanding in the literal sense. Let us first take a few examples of ordering devices that make some kind of sensibility possible. And many of us use such ordering devices for making sense of the past, to make your past narrative sensible. You follow some of the ordering devices. Now, when you use it, as I said earlier, you have a frame of mind, you have a framework of understanding, and you order them accordingly, and it is a priori. I am now saying it is not a priori which is important, because a priori is a universal kind of trait in the case of any narrative, including storytelling. There is a priori reasoning. But in a posteriori, you have a self-conscious attempt at critique your causality, critique your generalization, and then make sure that the outcome is reliable, relatively reliable. Now, what do you find in historiography as common devices or methods of making the narrative sensible? One very common ordering in sensing the past is chronological ordering. And you will also do it as chronological sequencing. Another is imperialistic ordering. I don't have to explain further how did imperialistic ordering come, and it's part of British colonialism, British imperialism, and we inherited the craft of writing the past or sensing the past from the British colonial writers. So there is what you call imperialistic ordering, and then dynastic ordering, and epochal sequencing. You identify certain epochs, ancient, medieval, modern, and you order your knowledge of the past accordingly. Nationalist ordering and regionalist ordering. These are not mere ordering, but these are rendered plausible with the help of a certain theory in mind, certain explanation in mind. You have certain presumptions very strongly, entrenched presumptions. Although all of us may not be conscious about the principle behind the ordering that we choose. For example, the chronological ordering, there is the notion of progress or development as part of your value judgment. And why I call it value judgment will be clear to you when we come to the subsequent phase of my lecture. Similarly, imperialistic ordering, it has the framework of understanding by the imperialists, the British colonialists, and they were interested in celebrating order. They were interested in projecting order as the clearest symptom of progress. And when there is imperial rule, then there is progress. That's what they presumed, because they used the history to show that. Their rule was a rule with certain order, and their interest was to move from disorder to order. The imperial rule meant orderly governance, and that indicated a phase of progress. And also they wanted to communicate that the best orderly phase is the imperial phase. They don't call it imperial, but their rule. And then that showed the highest phase of development. And they historically identified such phases in the past. Imperial order, and they identified it as golden age. And wherever they found disorder, and they called it dark age. You know it. You know these sort of explanations, interpretations. Now, dynastic ordering. There is an extension of the imperial governance in this classification or in this ordering. Influence of the imperial ordering is explicit here. Now, epochal sequencing, we inherited this from James Mill, who classified Indian history into three periods: ancient period, medieval period, and modern period. And later on, Christian Classen made it explicitly communal by talking about the ancient Hindu period, medieval Muslim period, and modern Christian period. Although James Mill did not make communal clarity about the modern period, but he was very clear about the characteristic feature of the ancient and medieval in communal terms. Now, nationalistic ordering. Nationalistic ordering has state behind. It is the concept of state which is at work. It is state-centric. When your thinking is state-centric, it's inevitably top-down. You think about the state on top and then you come down. So it is an approach that is top-down. Then regionalist ordering. There is recurrence of the state centricity and top-down approach in this. So these are ordering principles, and then their, I would say, ideological presuppositions. All the above have their scale, macro as well as micro. Let us take a few examples of micro ordering or sorting. I mean, now when you talk about an epoch, It's a macro level ordering, ancient period or medieval period or modern period. These epochal are macro level classification or periodization. Now let us come to micro level organization or micro level sorting. Archaeologists' micro classification, micro level sorting of their own understanding of the past. They make sense of the past by sorting them into cultures. Cultures based on the site or based on the dominant remains or certain typical artifacts, mainly pottery type or monumental relics. Now, for example, they talk about Kulli culture, for example, pre-Harappan cultures, Kulli culture, Nal culture, Zob culture, all these are site-based in the sense that, you know, a culture anthropologically means something else. Or to make it clear, according to Malinowski, for example, culture was a complex set of practices whose underlying purpose was to serve the needs of individuals. Taylor tried to define culture as that complex whole which includes knowledge, belief, art, law, morals, customs, and all other capabilities and habits acquired by a society. Marx viewed culture as the class practices that would justify or hush up inequality. Now, any explanation of culture you take won't help you make Kulli culture something intelligible or Nal culture intelligible or Sob culture intelligible. What is this culture in terms of these attributes that archaeologists would call these as cultures, because they are interested in characterizing one excavated site, and they have identified some features and they call it on the basis of the site labeled as a culture unit. Similarly, they talk about copper hoard culture. It is on the basis of the dominant remains. Otherwise, in typical anthropological sense, you don't find anything called copper hoard culture. Like that megalithic culture, it is based on the principal monument type, principal monuments, burial monuments of a face. It's on the basis of what they find as monumental among the remains. Then black and red ware culture, it's a pottery type. Painted grey ware culture, northern black polished ware culture, etc. So many examples are there. Anthropological understanding of culture is something totally different from this. You have a curious way of sorting out archaeological sensing of the past in terms of cultures. Archaeologists' identification of culture is not only exclusive, but also too representational to be closer to historical truth. In the sense, historians won't be able to identify these in terms of cultures. That's the reason why I'm saying it is too representational. Historians generally follow the archaeologists' sorting to a certain extent, but they identify periods on the basis of sources they master. Some of us would be having more technical competency in handling certain sources. There are epigraphists among us, competent in reading and understanding inscriptions, and they would be generally associating a certain distinct set of inscriptions for identifying a period. I will make it clear taking a specific example from my own specialization, the early history of South India. Before giving you the example, let me also say that historians follow the practice of faceting their narrative into narrative focus into the social, economic, political, cultural, and religious. These are all aspects of society, but they consider these as independent facets. They always assume that the social is independent of the economic is independent of the political, like that. I use consciously the term faceting, which is a geometrical term, that now according to geometry, you can have a big geometrical structure. Parts of which can be removed without disturbing the structure, because each part is intelligible in itself. That is faceting, faceting in geometry. It is important in the context. Historians are faceting the social, the economic, the political, the cultural, and the religious, almost as independent constituents. Accordingly, historians, now I am coming to the example I promised. Early history of the Tamil South is represented as, I am saying, experts in various source material. Some archaeologists who have studied Iron Age remains, they identify Iron Age culture based on iron artifacts excavated by them. Then black and red ware culture, because they have portraits of black and red ware in a given site, so they call it black and red ware culture. Then megalithic culture, as I said earlier, heterodox culture, because the historians come across inscriptions referring to the Jain, Buddhist, Ajivika orders. So such heterodox religions are indicated, or the existence of monks of these orders is attested by inscriptions. So taking these inscriptions together, they talk about heterodox culture. Then maritime civilization. This is on the basis of Greco-Roman accounts, and then a large number of gold coins discovered in Hordes. And they identify that as the period of a maritime civilization. Then Sangam Age, they have Sangam literature. And on the basis of Sangam literature, they talk about Sangam polity, Sangam age, Sangam culture, life in the age of the Sangam, and all kinds of such things. If you think about all these culture, now how do you identify these cultures? Where do you locate? You know that it is largely the Tamil macro region which is referred to what is Iron Age in Tamil macro region? What is megalithic culture in the Tamil macro region, or heterodox culture in the Tamil macro region, and then the Sangam age, Sangam culture, and so on. So if you take the whole thing together in chronological perspective, you find they are chronologically overlapping, but they all converge in the same place. And despite overlap, there is convergence of chronology. And then it becomes interesting that if you take the so-called Sangam literature as Tamil heroic anthologies, and then if you make cross verifications of archaeological material with allusions in the heroic poems, you find a lot of similarity over there. And then subsequently you identify that both archaeology and Tamil heroic poems talk about one and the same culture. Archaeology is able to tell you about a more archaic phase, but of the same culture. And the cave labels talk about traders and then heterodox monks and so on of one phase, which is part of the larger chronological framework, which means there is no point in calling the history of a given period in various not only names but terms of terms meant to indicate culture, specific cultures like Iron Age culture, black and red ware culture, megalithic culture, Sangam culture, and so on. But people are the same. We have to think about people and their topography, land and people. When you think like that, all these source material would converge. But how do you think like that? You need theory for it. As a student who tried to understand the period in this sense, I experienced it and I tried it. And I found social formation theory extremely useful for this. What is social formation theory? It's largely the same as the theory of mode of production, integral to the theory of historical materialism, but with the niceties and nuances added by philosophers like Louis Althusser, Balibar, Barry Hindes, Paul Q. Hurst, and then anthropologists who are Marxists, but they linked their Marxist theory with structuralism. Structuralism is initiated by philosophers themselves. Anthropologists like Maurice Godelier, Emmanuel Terre, Nikos Poulantzas, Pierre-Philippe Rey, Claude Millasou, and others. It is in the economic manuscripts Marx talks about Gesellschaftsformen, that is social formation. And it's intelligible. It's intelligible and much more communicative compared to the theory of mode of production. Theory of mode of production is subsumed by the theory of social formation. All these people I mentioned added certain explanatory explanatory forms to accommodate niceties and nuances. Now, on the whole, I have found Nikos Poulantzas' definition of social formation quite intelligible and not fundamentally deviating from Marx's notion of Gesellschaft formen. Poulantzas said, although Marx was talking about mode of production, Marx knew that in any period there would be unevenly evolved means of subsistence. You can call them economies. Even now we have hunters living with us. Primitive agriculture is living with us. They are in their own ecotypes. But in one way or other, they are all influenced by one dominant economy. Poulantzas tried to define social formation, therefore, as a combination of several unevenly evolved economies, but structured by the dominance of one. That one economy is what Marx calls the dominant economy. And that dominant economy prevails as the mode of production, or its technology, the forces of production, its relations of production, and its means would prevail. And that mode of production would, in one way or other, influence all other forms. Now, Poulantzas also makes it clear that it doesn't mean that the dominant economy is the superior one in terms of technology and productivity. It is not on the basis of technology and productivity that you find in the past an economy is capable of dominating. This is not something discussed by Marx, but you know, Marx preoccupied with capitalism, never thought seriously about the possibility of a technologically inferior, and inferior in terms of productivity, becoming the dominant economy of a period. And that happened during the period that we are talking about, the period of agro-pastoral activities, agro-pastoral life. Agricultural communities were there, pastoral communities were there, there existed wet rice agriculture in small pockets, but largely agriculture meant millet cultivation, and they utilized the red soil tracks and then the wet pockets in the Dale and high altitude areas. They were not capable of accessing deltas at that stage. Their technology was not appropriate for that. And evidently, it's very clear that wet rice agriculture was superior in terms of technology, superior in terms of productivity. But wet rice agriculture economy was not the dominant one during the period. And there are various indications in the source material for that. One very important example is the political practices of the time were utterly inimical to the wet rice agriculture. Political practice was blunder based, and blunder was fundamental to the period because the chieftains plundered and then pooled the resources, pooled the booty, and redistributed that. It was a redistributive society. A redistributive agropastoral society, although had wet rice agriculture, depended heavily on millet cultivation and pastoral products, and they rather circulated the resources in two ways. One, through cattle raids and then redistribution of the captured cattle, and then plundering the agrarian settlements, and then redistribution of the grain and millet. That kind of social formation existed during the period. So agro-pastoral social formation would make the period intelligible for a theoretically knowledgeable person, and it becomes then very easy to see all these rather meaningless sorting, like Sangam age, Sangam culture, Sangam polity, or Iron Age culture, early historic culture, black and red ware culture, megalithic culture, and so on, or heterodox culture, the period of maritime civilization. All these coexisted, all these practices coexisted, and you have in certain areas hunters and gatherers existing, and in certain areas student cultivators, slash and burn cultivators, and in certain areas cattle rearing people, and some people as full-time plunderers. And in spite of all these, through the long network of traders moving and exchanging goods, and it involved even maritime commerce. Mediterraneans coming in their vessel, crossing the Indian Ocean and reaching, and then carrying the spices they wanted. I'm not going into the details of this, but we will have certain instances to illustrate some advantages of the theory subsequently. Now, we will go now into the specific service that theory offers. Now, one is evidence dissolves itself and gets constituted afresh before theory. How does theory do this magic? For example, discovery of Roman coin hoards in various places of South India as evidence of maritime civilization. You cannot immediately contradict when somebody is arguing for the existence of maritime civilization. Even now, people believe in this. People speak about maritime civilization, overseas civilization, various river valley civilizations, you know, Periyar civilization, Chalakudi river civilization, whatnot. You have all kinds of discussion about it, all based on certain remains. And about maritime civilization, the clinching evidence is Roman coin hoards, a lot of Roman gold and silver coins, gold in bullion, recovered from various places, but in hoards. But why hoards? Nobody asked. But coin hoards became important because coins came from Rome, and huge hoards show that they all got accumulated through trade, the concept of Indo-Roman trade, and then accumulation of gold coins to the level of a Roman senator Pliny becoming anxious about the drain of gold from Rome, that kind of thing. All these are pieces of evidence. This evidence disappears before the anthropological theory of forms of exchange and differentiation between the exchange practices in non-monetized and monetized societies. Differentiation between use value and exchange value, between reciprocity and trade, between money as medium of exchange, as measure of value and means of payment. These are important. An archaeologist who is ignorant about anthropological theories will see, certainly talk about all kinds of civilizations and cultures and so on of this type. But unconsciously, there is the influence of neoclassical notion of political economy, neoclassical economics of trade. Neoclassical economics doesn't make any difference between exchange in the past and exchange in modern times. Exchange is exchange, it is profit oriented for them. They have no idea about exchange based on use, exchange based on the notion of use value only. It has nothing to do with exchange value. People had no idea about price and profit. In that kind of a setup, forms of exchange differed. Reciprocity, redistribution, as I meant earlier, gift, and various ways of circulating the leftover existed in the past. And these societies that followed reciprocity, redistribution, gift, and so on, I'm not saying gift did not continue, but as a principal means of circulating the resource, they were of non-monetized society. And you have trade conducting society with the notion of exchange value and therefore concept of profit. You have society with no notion of price, profit, and interest, and then society with the concept of price, profit, interest, and so on. When these two societies enter into the relationship of exchange, one section, that is the profit-making section, will understand it as trade. But non-monetized, non-profit-oriented section would understand it only as exchange of their kind. So it's a trading group engaged in barter or reciprocity, which means gold coins become part of primordial valuables and objects of barter in that kind of society. And there are indications, I don't want to go into the details, about the non-monetized status of the society in early Tamil Nadu. Then what happens? The evidence of the maritime civilization protagonists will disappear in the light of anthropological theory of forms of exchange and differentiation between the exchange practices in non-monetized and monetized societies, differentiation between use value and exchange value, and so on. So like that, theory makes the invisible visible. Example, social differentiation is not visible in the archaeologist's discussion of the pottery typology of terracotta vessels, its technology, stratigraphy, and distribution. So archaeologists study typology of the pottery, then technology, stratigraphy, and distribution. And they take all these together as a marker of culture. Therefore, they talk about painted grayware culture, northern black polish ware culture, and so on. Social theory will help you understand the scenario better. They look into the archaeological remains as a whole. They don't follow the archaeologist's classification of the pottery and then identification of the culture on the basis of the best pottery, the slipware or fashionable pottery. Now take painted grayware along with iron implements and black and red ware and also various other pots with the huge chunk of coarseware, rough potsherds. Same is the case with the northern black polishware. Highly sophisticated ceramic, but you have hundreds of times a huge stock of coarseware, very rough kind of pots, and its shards are found in huge numbers. So they think about pottery in the context of social differentiation. They ask the question, a social theoretically informed person asks the question, who might have used the painted grayware? Who might have used this sophisticated ware? Anyway, very few. Because you have a huge stock of rough potsherds. Similarly, northern black polishware, Mauryan pottery, Mauryan urban pottery, Mauryan tableware. Aristocrats might have used these. How can you call the culture as NBP culture? And then the previous phase, painted grayware, the Iron Age of the post Late Vedic period. How can you associate this culture, this pottery with the culture of the time? You think about the place where you discovered this and people who lived there. It is not just the painted grayware users who lived there. And then slightly later period, the Mauryan period, it is not northern black polish ware users alone who existed there. A greater number of people existed as dasas and dasis, as bratakas. They took wheat gruel in coarseware, not in black polish ware. So in BGW phase also, many dasas and dasis existed, bratakas existed. They had their vessel, and then aristocrats had. The swamis and the gahapadis had their vessels. Unless you ask these sort of questions to the evidence, you won't be able to understand the actual social context of the artifacts, nature of society. But in archaeological classification, this visibility is not there. This is what I am saying. That theory is capable of making the invisible visible. So social theory makes the invisible in the context, that is social differentiation, visible. Then theory fills in gaps How does a theory fill the gap? I have already given you a good illustration from geometry at the beginning itself. There is methodological identification of parts of the whole out of indications in the sources. You have to keep the system, however tentative it is, structure in mind. A system is not just a system. A social system is a determinate pattern of human relations. And human relations are based on relations of production. Relations of production are based on forces of production. The theory helps you to reach out into the way society was organized in terms of their subsistence pattern and the technology and knowledge involved in it. Forces of production do not mean just technology alone, but the knowledge as well. A society is understood in detail, rather scientifically, with the help of the theory. A person who has no idea about the forces and relations of production, or a person who doesn't think about people in terms of a structured entity in the context of the aggregate of their economic practices, they have no such questions, and they would never look into the source material for clues. There are clues, but clues not identifiable. And sometimes a theoretical explanation alone will make indicators in the source material visible, and you will have to piece together such clues to constitute what is called evidence. Evidence, therefore, is not out there for anybody to go and pick. You can pick them only if you are theoretically knowledgeable. So historical source material becomes extremely useful for a person capable of exhausting the clues in them, the indicators in them, for which the researcher has to be theoretically knowledgeable. What I mean by historical sensing of the past is using sources with theoretical insights and then identify signifiers and then try to reach from the known to the unknown, try to fill in gaps and try to make things invisible visible and so on. So when I thought of the theme sensing the past with the theory, sources and invisible evidence, I really meant that evidence relates to your argument, and your argument ensues from your framework of understanding, that is theory. Your narrative is theoretical, and therefore you have certain needs, and your needs in terms of evidence will be met by the same old source. Always you are not discovering new source material. Old source material becomes useful for a theoretically knowledgeable person because he or she is able to identify signifiers in them. Thank you very much. Was I audible?
Yes, sir.
I have ended my question.
Thank you, sir, for the informative and illuminating talk. Now the session is open for discussion. You can type your queries into the chat box.
I didn't ask about the time allotted at the beginning. I do not know whether I have used up the entire time so that nobody is able to ask any question. Yes.
Jerina Antony. Sir, generally, theories are formulated from the conclusions of the particular study. This theory is then applied to a new problem. Wouldn't applying a previously formulated theory be a hindrance to the holistic understanding or reading of the past? Can you please comment also with the respect to interdisciplinary studies?
So many things put together. Now let me try to sort out the thing first. See, theory is not anything that is taken out from a specific context. The theory is reached through hypothetical deductive process, and then there is always the possibility of using theory deductively, but it is not necessary always for checking the validity of a theory without studying its intelligibility in the context of what we focus. And there is no attempt at taking theory with the Procrustean discipline. Theory is not amenable to any change, and therefore you size your problem to suit the theory. That's not. Even if your situation suits very much, if you just superimpose the theory, that is nothing but theoretical empiricism. You have to theoretically read and understand your situation and characterize it. Then various locally specific, culturally specific things will emerge. So theory is not anything which is imposing on you to blindly follow it and then equate what you study with it. But remember, without at least an a priori kind of reasoning, you cannot do any research. You cannot, by research, you cannot discuss any problem. I am talking about a much more critically reflexive stage, the stage of a posteriori, where you have a chance to critically revisit your own a priori understanding, and you have a critical self-reflexivity over there, and make your characterization as transparent as possible. And your responsibility is to make the relationship between the signifiers that you identify from the source material and then your interpretation transparent. There should be transparency about the process of your characterization. And then you have shifted to an entirely different thing, interdisciplinary. Let me quickly as to... I do not know who is speaking. Please switch off your microphone until I finish. Interdisciplinary is not what generally people think. Interdisciplinary is not multidisciplinary. Interdisciplinary is something which is conceiving as a field of knowledge that does not belong to any of the established. That is how women's studies came up. environmental studies came up. They don't belong to any particular discipline. Dalit studies, for example. So they come up with their own evolving epistemology, contours, and boundaries. They don't belong to any of the established disciplines. And therefore, they are interdisciplinary fields of knowledge. Multidisciplinary is as good as disciplinary. It is academically attacking an object of knowledge from different angles of different disciplines. So multidisciplinary approach is actually disciplinary approach. And I do not know how you wanted to link up with what I said. Anyway, let us leave it there. Yes, other questions?
Thank you, sir. Sumannath has a question. Compared to theory, there is another approach called ethnoarchaeology. What is your take on that?
Ethnoarchaeology is a field method. And long back, Malinowski talked about fieldwork as the researcher experiencing the life of people which is subjected to study. It's living with people, practicing their ritual, practicing their practices, and all sorts of things, their rituals, ideas, beliefs, and so on. And then you understand it. It's not going to people with questionnaires ready in hand, and then you do your interview, and then you record all kinds of things, and you come back. You have certain ideas in mind, and then you discover that in their life. That is taking knowledge to people and then claiming it in the name of people. You have to take knowledge out of people, for which you have to do field work. As early anthropologists conceived, Robert Browning, or earlier. Ethno-methodology of Garfinkel and so on. That came later, and that is a different kind of classification of the source material and so on. I don't find any theory over there. Ethno-methodology is not a theory. There I have to clarify. See, when you talk about a technique, you have to use the term method. Method is the way of doing, the technique of doing. Methodology is the science of the way of doing. So when you say methodology, there should be a science behind it. There should be a theoretical knowledge behind it, theoretical knowledge base of it. Otherwise, you call it a method. I call the so-called ethno-methodology as ethnic method or ethnological method. I don't think it is methodology. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Next question from Srinivas Rao. I'm happy that you have made clear that all the historical narratives are same. However, my question is politics of employing theory. My question is, do you think it is possible for the elite to employ theory as a tool to make the evidence of the other forever?
I missed the last part. Theory of theory. I didn't get the theory of employ.
It's there in the chat box too, sir.
Chat box is not visible to me.
Okay.
Can you read it once again?
Okay.
Loudly, please.
Is politics of employing theory? My question is, do you think it is possible for the elite to employ theory as a tool to make the evidence of the other forever?
Yes. See, that is always possible. Marx himself made it very clear that Marxism is an additional tool of oppression and exploitation if it is being used by the bourgeoisie. A university professor is very well as a bourgeois, and he or she can use Marx theory as an additional tool for marginalizing people, exploiting people, and so on. But the advantage is the theory as such, as the theory of theory, can understand that process as well. And Marx always made it clear that Marx theory can become a mover in society only if it is available to the teased and frustrated in society. The most exploited should get it, and then they would be able to use it as a prime mover. Otherwise, it would be another component for enhancing the strategy of containment. You are right. There is the possibility of the marginalized or the other further marginalized through this strategy.
Thank you, sir. Next question from Safir VM. Sir, in your last lecture in KCHR series, you say the Mesolithic or Microlithic are found in between Paleolithic era. Is it right commonly Microlithic came after Paleolithic era?
Yes, microliths are late stone tools, and in the case of Kerala, because of the landscape ecosystem and then the undulating terrain and all that, Neolithic settlements do not seem to have flourished much. So late Stone Age continued until the iron came. Until the arrival of iron, microliths were in use, and it seems that microlithic people existed extensively in the Midland Kerala plains, rich with water bodies and marshes, marshy area. Various reptiles of the marshy area, turtle and so on, and also the biomass of the water bodies. They were the resources for microlithic people to subsist. We have identified among the microlithic tools a large number of arrowheads and we are not sure whether they were arrowheads, but burins and points. They might have used it as the edge of a pole, and various fish in the marshy areas must have been hunted by them, and that was enough for them to subsist like that. But suddenly their technology underwent a change when the iron smelting people came in, and definitely there was no chance of direct combat between the microlithic people and then the iron smelting people. They might have certainly accepted the superiority of the iron using people and might have served the people and shared the technology. From iron smelting people, they might have got the craft of preparing arrows and arrowheads, which earlier were flints. They might have replaced their flint arrowhead with iron arrowhead. And also they might have used the iron-tipped poles for hunting crocodiles and various fish. This is only a presumption, and it is not my interpretation. This is what some of the knowledgeable archaeologists see about Kerala. And also that accounts for the absence of extensive Neolithic cells in the Kerala region, and also total absence of a Neolithic settlement.
Thank you, sir. Uma Pandey has a I was aware I first did field work and then read theories, which made me more enthusiastic about going through several theories, which otherwise was difficult to understand when I started my research.
Yeah. Anyway, one has to be at least familiar with some of the well-known anthropological theories before going to the field. Otherwise, a revisit will be necessary. You can identify certain riddles and problems and so on, and then consult the theories, and then a revisit. That is also a method, but the principle remains the same, that you cannot identify certain things without being theoretically knowledgeable.
Next question from Soumya Varghese. Sir, as follow-up to the earlier question, while theory is important to having a narrative, how can you avoid getting trapped in the theory and arranging data to prove it?
No, that is against methodology. Methodology tells you to identify your research questions and have a tentative answer, a tentative set of answers. That's what you call your hypothetical formulations. And a hypothesis is not to be sustained. You have to study the sources thoroughly. And finally, you reach a point that, if not entirely, many of your hypothetical presumptions get disproved. A serious study will disprove the central hypothesis. The main reason is a hypothesis is your a priori generalization. Hypothetical understanding is entirely based on a priori reasoning. When it comes to methodology driven a posteriori reasoning, a priori would remain corrected.
Thank you, sir. Aparna has a question. How can we use regionalistic ordering in our research work?
What order?
Regionalistic ordering.
Regionalistic. I was saying that there are various entrenched ordering in historical writings. I was not in favor of any of them. That's the reason why I pointed out the ideological presupposition behind. The regionalistic ordering has the problem of nationalistic ordering, and the ideological presupposition is state centrism there. And even when you take a village in a region, you think from the top. It is top down because you have state in mind. State becomes the political unconscious in your thinking. You are not able to be self-consciously realistic about it. Therefore, it is already there. And you don't think about the a device of classification or framing your narrative. Your narrative occurs like that. That is how you have learned history. One has to be self-critical in this way, thinking about the pattern of organization of your material, asking the question, why am I organizing my essay in this particular pattern? Even when you discuss an ancient society, theoretically, if you do not know that it was a society of the pre-state times, it was a pre-state society, then if you narrate the society with the shared assumptions of a state system, the whole narrative would be utterly anachronistic. because you do not recognize that you're talking about a society that was not class structured and that had no governance system distinguished as, I mean, distinguished from their kin, clan, organization, and so on. State was not possible there. And a theoretically knowledgeable person would immediately see that state is precluded in that kind of a society. But a theoretically untrained person won't recognize this and will run into the trouble of anachronism.
Thank you, sir. Preeti George has a question. Sir, there are several theories. Where can one start in trying to develop theoretical knowledge as a student of history in general?
You may have so many theories, and some of them are not theories, although they claim to be. Anyway, there is not that kind of a supermarket of theories, and then you are not that free to go and do shopping of theories. Regarding history, you have to be knowledgeable first with Marx. You don't have any other theory of history. Although there is one by Hegel, it's of a different kind. It is not possible to use Hegelian thing in historical writing. And then you have various social theories, anthropological theories, and so on. But there isn't any macro level framework for understanding the past, like historical materialism. But historical materialism, as I already pointed out, has been growing, whether you are afraid about revisionism, that kind of accusation, or not. Now you remain a student who should have an open mind to scholarly writings, and then you will see that historical materialism has been growing as historical methodology. And then that will act as theory of theory on the one side. That will help you weed out the so-called pretentious formulations having claim of being theories. They won't survive. See, they won't have epistemological existence as theory. If you go ahead with a good grip in Marx's framework of understanding the past, then it becomes possible for you to integrate with it without being eclectical. Or you can even say that I don't bother about being accused for eclecticism. I see these theories sensible in these contexts, and I understand historical materialism or social formation theory quite sensible in this specific context. So I use them together. A Marxist will certainly criticize you for being eclectic. But anyway, without being eclectic also, you can integrate theories. For example, theory of Malinowski, you can use them. And some of the sociological theories, theory of substantivists like Karl Polanyi, is not a Marxist, but you can use certain aspects of Karl Polanyi. I have used it. And also I have claimed in my thesis, in the introduction itself, my central framework of comprehension is historical materialism. But I have used Marcel Mauss or Marshall Silence, Karl Polanyi, and various anthropologists for that matter. Godelier, Emmanuel Terre, they are all Marxists, but a rigid Marxist will not approve them. Rigid Marxist will not approve of what they say. But I have found them quite useful. So you can certainly use a central theory, but you should be convincing about the epistemological status of the theory in your own understanding. You don't have to blindly follow the theory, because among a set of scholars, the epistemological status of historical materialism is well entrenched. It is unassailable. Despite a large number of criticisms against historical materialism, it remains largely unassailable at its fundamental level. And it is incomplete anyway. You will have to depend upon various anthropological theories for explaining certain specific contexts of institutions, specific contexts of positions and functions. You cannot explain caste system using Marx theory alone. Marx, of course, understands caste as class. It is an institutional apparatus of class for establishing sovereign control over labor. But that alone will not be enough to explain the social consequences of the persistence of caste as a very strong institution. Continuation of caste beyond the social formation of its origins, and then continuing still as one of the strong unconquered elements in society, still unconquered. So the theory alone, one theory alone will not help you understand that. You will have to follow some of the Dalit formulations and so on. Dalit formulation seriously is coming up with its own epistemology. It's an epistemological critique. And how you integrate historical materialism with the Dalit framework of comprehension? Many Dalits have done that. Many Dalits have distanced themselves from Marx understanding. Same is the case with feminist understanding. There are non-Marxist and even anti-Marxist feminists, but there are very well-known Marxist feminist scholars.
Shiva came has a question. There may be several formulations within a single theoretical model. For example, the Marxist with E.P. Thompson, Althusser, and others drawing different aspects of Marxism. Could you narrate with examples from research on Kerala?
No, you have contingent explanations, but based on the core of Marxist formulation. They don't deny the theory of mode of production, or they don't deny the final proposition that the economic or material force is the last determinant. Fundamentally, at the end, it is the economy that matters, and it is the economic factor that would go about deciding the fact. But some people did not understand Marxism as a theoretical proposition talking about the simultaneity of the material and non-material. You don't have one evolving first and then the other following. There is a very complex kind of continuity about it. But even there, as the last instance, it is the material force that would go ahead as the decisive instance, as Althusser said. You cannot call what Althusser did, or what Balibar and Hinders and Poulantzas and Claude Milasso and others did. They are all Marxists. But they are opening up certain areas where Marx himself was not able to shed any light. That is it.
Thank you, sir. Nandri Jena has a question. Sir, in understanding and researching on areas of social history where knowledge is not so fragmentary and more source materials are present, do theories are still absolutely necessary?
You know, see, history is always fragmentary. It is much more so in the case of early history. But don't think that you will be able to restore history of last week in total. It is gone. And then you cannot have a huge assembly of facts about what happened last week and then claiming to have achieved a successful, truthful narrative of that. It is much more bewildering. Without a framework, you won't be able to understand even the very recent history that I'm talking about. So history is incomplete. That is the fate of the discipline. And even if it is history of very recent times, it is incomplete. It is a tentative discipline. It is incomplete. And it cannot be approached without a framework of comprehension. If there is no theory, there is no history.
Thank you, sir. Minu Rebecca has a question. Can we blindly believe a theory? Can we go against a theory if we find it wrong?
Yeah, anyway, you don't have to follow any theory blindly. You have to understand the ontology and epistemology of a theoretical formulation. You have to understand it in the context of the science of knowledge. Okay? And then, if there are contesting theories, what does it mean? Nobody is disallowing the rise of theories, alternative theories. There are theories and they would come up and sometimes there would be a fundamental break with the pre-existing theory. That is how knowledge grows. You don't find this kind of rigid biographical tagging of theory in science. Nobody is talking about physics like this. I am not a Newtonian, or I am not an Einsteinian. Even when you do quantum mechanics, you don't ignore Einstein or Newton. And Einstein, who said quantum mechanics is not physics, but you work with the propositions of Heisenberg and Niels Bohr and various physicists like that. There is no biography-based discussion of knowledge in science. But unfortunately, any theory is turned into an ideology. Even a theory that is utterly opposed to the thing called ideology. Marx, for example. Marx wrote a huge volume, German Ideology. That was the major study made by him. And the whole exercise was to prove that theory is totally different from ideology. Theoretical exposition of a phenomenon is epistemologically valid exposition, whereas ideology is distortion of truth. It is ontology that loses any epistemological ground. But now you find even Marxists talking about Marxist ideology and so on. Marx might be gyrating in his grave hearing this Marxist pratyashastra, Marxist ideology. There isn't anything called a Marxist ideology. You can talk only about Marxist theory. Now, I think I missed the central part of the question. What was the question? Why did I say this? Was there any mention of ideology?
No, the question was, can we go against a theory if we find it wrong?
Yes. Yeah, theory can be proved wrong through a relationship of encounter with it, not with ideological factors, but with theoretical issues. That's why I am saying it should be an epistemological encounter. And so far I haven't found any theory that has totally upset Marx's theory of capitalism, Marx's theory of surplus value, or Marx's theory of commodity fetishism. I haven't seen that. Fundamentals of Marx's theory, as far as I am concerned, remain. And again, as a student of history, I haven't found any other useful framework for understanding the past. But that doesn't mean that all historians follow Marx's historical materialism. They don't accept. There are many political economists who follow neoclassical economics for writing economic history. That's a person's choice. And also there may be restrictions in various places, because unlike the case of Einstein or Newton or scientists, you find Marx's theory tagged with a political outlet, and it is anti-capitalist. Therefore, naturally, capitalist establishments and capitalist countries would be against it. So you cannot write openly a thesis justifying Marx in any of the universities in USA unless you are so wanted globally. If you are not a globally recognized scholar, you will lose even your career if you write a thesis celebrating Marx's historical materialism. That kind of situation doesn't exist in the case of any other discipline. So many people I have encountered talking about argument, talking about your argument problematic because it is Marxist. I used to tell them, see, you are labeling it, you go further. What is said by saying your argument is Marxist? My response is, I am arguing in a Marxist way, but what is the problem? You tell me. You have to encounter that epistemologically, and then you can substitute it. That way, any theory can be substituted. And there are attempts like that. And for that matter, Marx's theory is a contested theory, although it is still having its space in spite of the postmodern celebration of doubts and postmodern celebration of local theory, local understanding. They don't talk about theory. They dismiss any totalizing theory valid. Marx's theory being a totalizing theory, they dismiss it as an invalid grand theory. But you don't find a theory as such substituting it. They unseat theory as the domain, not any particular theory. But it is possible. Now, if you have enough material, I mean material relating to the history of knowledge production, history of the constitution of knowledge, and also enough epistemological elements to constitute a substitute for Marx's theory, you can replace it.
Thank you, sir. I hope that we don't have further questions.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your insightful answers, sir. So let's wrap up the session with a vote of thanks. I invite Ajit KG, Research Scholar, Department of History, Sri
Shankaracharya
University of
Kaladi
to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening to all. On behalf of the Department of History, Sri Shankaracharya University of Sanskrit, its entire fraternity and the organizing committee, I feel immense pleasure to take this opportunity to propose a vote of thanks to our eminent scholar, Dr. Rajan Gurukkal, who delivered a wonderful lecture on theoretical sensing of the past, sources, and invisible evidence. Thank you, sir, for your insightful lecture. I would like to thank all those who participated in the session. Thank you all.
Okay, may I leave the session?
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you all. It was nice to have you all here. Once again, thank you. Let's meet again on 3rd October for the next session. Thank you.